Welcome back, everyone. This week we talked about the Sun and the Moon, how the Moon goes around the Earth and the Sun itself. Today we'll talk about the Earth's rotation and revolution. Rotation means the spinning of Earth around its axis, making one complete turn every 24 hours. Now to us, this may seem obvious, but this wasn't always the case, and people had to prove it and show some evidence for it. One piece of evidence is called the Foucault pendulum. Foucault was a physicist in the 1800s, and he attached an iron ball to a pendulum 20 stories high. Physicists of the time knew that once a pendulum was set in motion, its direction of swing would not change. Foucault, however, observed that the direction did seem to change. Each hour it shifted clockwise, but because the pendulum can't change direction, he concluded that the Earth beneath it was moving. This was the first piece of evidence that the Earth was rotating. Another piece of evidence that we discussed in this class that shows the Earth is rotating is the Coriolis effect, which is that the winds will curve right in the north and left in the south, and this is because of Earth's rotation. Now we said Earth is going to turn on its axis. The axis is an imaginary line that goes straight through the Earth between the north and south poles, and as Earth turns, it rotates on its axis. Like other planets, Earth travels around the Sun and rotates while it travels. The path around the Sun is the Earth's plane of orbit, but Earth's axis isn't perpendicular to the plane, meaning it's not going to be standing straight. Rather, Earth's axis is on a 23.5-degree tilt. Earth's axis points towards Polaris, or the North Star, which we talked about earlier this year. The tilt of Earth's axis will stay the same throughout the whole year, and this is called parallelism. Because of this, Polaris is always going to appear in the same place in the northern hemisphere. So how long does it take for Earth to make one complete rotation? Earth makes one complete turn of 360 degrees every 24 hours. So if you divide 360 by 24, we get a rate of 15 degrees per hour. The effect of Earth's rotation is the daily change from day to night, and this causes the Sun and Moon to appear to rise and set each day. Time zones were created as a solution to the problem that different areas on Earth are going to see the Sun at different times of the day. Since the Earth turns 15 degrees per hour, every 15 degrees of longitude is another hour of clock time. The international dateline represents where the day changes. If you're going westward of the international dateline, you move one day later, and going eastward, it's one day earlier. Now the Earth will also move around the Sun, and this is called revolution, the movement of Earth in its orbit around the Sun. Evidence that Earth is revolving is that groups of stars called constellations will appear to change their position in the sky throughout the year, or sometimes not be visible at all. This is because Earth's position in space is going to change. Earth's orbit is an ellipse, meaning the distance will change throughout the whole year. The Earth is nearest to the Sun in January and is farthest from the Sun in July. Earth makes one complete revolution around the Sun every 365.25 days, and this defines the length of a year. One orbit is 360 degrees, so the rate of revolution is going to be just under 1 degree per day. Earth's revolution has many effects for us on Earth. One of the causes is that the Sun's path across our sky is going to change throughout the year. The point where the Sun is the highest in the sky is called zenith. Another effect of the Earth's revolution is the seasonal change and the change in the length of day and night. Because of the 23-degree tilt, at any given time, one half of Earth is going to be tilted towards the Sun, and the other half, or hemisphere, is going to be tilted away. Equinox is 2 days each year when neither hemisphere is tilted towards the Sun, making day and night equal all over the world. The spring equinox is on or around March 21st, and the autumnal equinox is around September 21st. The summer solstice is when the north is at its maximum tilt towards the Sun. This creates the longest day, since the Sun's path in the sky is going to be the longest, and it's going to go the highest than any other day of the year. The first day of summer in the northern hemisphere is on June 21st. During the summer, the Sun is the highest in the sky in the north. And because the sun's tilt is 23.5 degrees, the sun is going to be completely overhead at locations along 23.5 degrees north latitude. And this line on the map is called the Tropic of Cancer. The winter solstice is the opposite, where the north is at its maximum tilt away from the sun. And this creates the shortest day, since the sun's path across our sky is the lowest and shortest than any other day of the year. The first day of winter in the north is on December 21st. During the winter, the sun is the lowest in the sky in the north. The sun is going to be overhead, or the highest in the sky, at locations along 23.5 degrees south latitude. And this line on the map is called the Tropic of Capricorn. When it's summer in the north, areas near the North Pole will have 24 hours of sunlight, and in the South Pole, 24 hours of darkness. When it's winter in the north, this is reversed, and in the North Pole, you're going to have 24 hours of darkness, and in the South Pole, 24 hours of light. That's all you need to know for today. Next week, we're going to talk about the planets. Please make sure to answer the questions correctly in the form below and hit that submit button. If you have any questions about what we did today, please send me a question in the Google Classroom and join me on Zoom. Thanks so much for watching. Have a great weekend.